Integumentary system, lecture three. So we ended our last lecture looking at glands, one of those glands being the sebaceous glands. Sebaceous glands are associated with hair follicles. They are found on the entire body except palms and soles. They produce and secrete that oily substance that we call sebum. That, of course, then flows into the follicle and then out onto the skin surface. By holocrine secretion, and that oils and lubricates the skin. As we said before, it helps protect the skin. It provides a waterproof source, and it protects the skin by helping to kill off bacteria, especially on the face. We also know that on the face and back, where you tend to have a lot of sebaceous glands and protection against bacteria, sometimes that those glands may fail to discharge the sebum, and that sebum would then collect, and then that's when you get the formation of a whitehead or a blackhead. If it's pus-inducing bacteria are also present, then a boil or a pimple can result, and that is when we get acne vulgaris. And acne vulgaris is the most common form of acne, and that basically is an inflammation of the sebaceous glands that also is most often seen during adolescence, during your time of life. And that is basically because of hormonal changes during puberty that causes sebaceous glands to become a little bit more active in your age groups. We also talked about sweat glands, how sweat glands cover the entire surface of the skin except for nipples and parts of the genitalia. Sweat glands, we also know, are sudoriferous glands. And here are different types of sudoriferous glands. You have eccrine or mirocrine sudoriferous glands. And these are the most numerous glands. Eccrine glands basically open onto the surface of the skin. And they open onto the surface of the skin through pores. Eccrine glands basically become more active when a person is hot, and it's a way for the body to maintain homeostasis by lowering body temperature as the sweat evaporates. So perspiration produced by these glands is true sweat. It's mostly water, at 99% water, but also in addition to water, you have salts and some traces of waste like urea. So therefore, sweat is a form of excretion of the body. Another type of gland is the apocrine gland. Apocrine glands, those are found in the axillary, anal, and genital areas only. These ducts open into hair follicles, so we tend to see these glands a little bit more active during puberty, and that's when they'll typically have the onset of their secretions. And we also know in today's day and age that their secretions may also act as a sex attractant. So we often heard of, you know, people being attracted to each other by their appearance. Well, apocrine glands and their secretions may also play a role in sex attraction. And that's what we would call the pheromones. So you've heard that word before. So pretty cool. The organic molecules in it will decompose with time. And of course, then you get the odor. So in those apocrine glands of the axillary region, when you have that odor buildup, that's of course when deodorant would come into play there. Then you have modified types of apocrine glands. Basically, the opening into the ear called the external ear canal is lined with serominous glands, and those are the glands that are going to be used in the ear to secrete earwax. These are modified sweat glands, and we call that cerumen, or just earwax in general. And then you also have mammary glands, and mammary glands are what secrete milk. So mammary glands are modified apocrine glands, sweat glands that produce milk only after giving childbirth. And if when we get to reproduction, we'll talk about that a little bit further. We did go through many disorders of the skin, athlete's foot, impetigo, canadensis, eczema, dandruff. You had your whole skin disorder project, so we're not going to get into a lot of those, but there are some that we should talk about in lecture, in addition to those ones that you studied in your skin disorder packet, and these are burns. And skin burns are basically threatening to life. What you do, what you think of with a skin burn is you have a catastrophic loss of bodily fluids. You get dehydration and you get fatal circulatory shock. And eventually what could happen is infection could set in. So a first responder going to the scene of a burn victim would care for the burn patient and for all other patients can summarize the burn victim by thinking of the letters A, B, C. So you do first A, establish an airway, B, make sure the person is breathing, and C, make sure that person has circulation. And that's what you learn in CPR. There are three basic types of burns. Burns basically account for approximately 1 million emergency department visits yearly in our country. The two criteria used to estimate burn severity is the depth and the thickness of the burn. So a first degree burn is typical of a sunburn, and that is the epidermal layer, and you get that redness appearance. The person experienced redness as in pain, but in general there are no blisters or swelling. The pain would subside then within 48 to 72 hours, and the injury heals without further complications or scarring. Sometimes damaged skin would peel off in about a week. In a second degree burn, you have damage to the epidermis and the upper dermis, and that would lead to blistering. A second degree burn is what you see in severe sunburns. So it's extended through the entire epidermis and part of the upper dermal layer. The person would experience redness and pain and would have blistering. Basically, the deeper the burn, the more prevalent the blisters, which can enlarge after the injury. And unless they become infected, the superficial second degree burns would heal in about 10 to 14 days without any complications or little scarring. But if the burn extends into the dermis deeper, it heals more slowly and would take basically 30 to 105 days. And the human, the healing of the epidermis would be extremely fragile, and scarring then would be seen. First and second degree burns are sometimes referred to as partial thickness burns. And then you have full thickness burns, which are third degree burns. Third degree burns are full thickness burns that destroy the entire thickness of the skin. The surface wound is leathery and may be brown or black. Pain receptors, blood vessels, sweat glands, sebaceous glands, hair follicles, all those accessory skin organs are destroyed. And then fourth degree burns involve tissues that go all the way down to the bone. Unless a very limited area of the body is affected, the patient at this point would not survive a fourth degree burn. So basically, when judging a burn, the burn severity and here you could see here, the burn severity then would be the rule of nines, and basically you use that to divide the body into nine regions: the head and neck, 9% of the total body surface, each upper limb, 9% each, the lower limb, 18% of the front and back portion of the body, 18% of the perineum, which includes the anal and the urogenital regions, and 1%, as you can see, in the perineum. So you have 9% appendages, 80%, 9% left and right leg, back up, 9% left and right arm, 18% for the legs, 1% for the perineum region, 36% for the abdominal region. Critical burns, over 10% of the body has third degree burns, 25% has second degree burns, and third degree burns on the face, hands, or feet. And then here you could see the rule of nines here. So anterior, posterior, head, neck, 9%, anterior, posterior, upper limbs, 18%, perineum, 1%, and the anterior and posterior lower limbs, 36%, 100% total. So estimate it by the rule of nines. The next thing to talk about is tumors. Benign, an example would be warts. So that would be an example of an irregular growth of cells, creating that cell mass, which we call a tumor. Cancer is associated with ultraviolet exposure, and it also increases skin aging. You have actinic keratosis, that's pre-malignant formation. You have basal cell, that's when the cells of the stratum basal layer, that's a type of cancer extending into that region of the cells. Basal cell carcinoma is basically the most common type of skin cancer. Basal cell carcinoma is the most common type of skin cancer. It begins when UV radiation causes the epidermal basal cells to form that tumor, and it suppresses the immune system's ability to detect the tumor. About 95% of the patients are easily cured by removal of the tumor, but reoccurrence is definitely common. And then you have squamous cell carcinoma, and that begins in the superficial cells of the epidermis, keratinocytes. While five times less common than basal cell carcinoma, it is more likely to spread to nearby organs, and death occurs in about 1% of cases. So this type does metastasize and spreads through the blood and lymph tissues. It too can be triggered by ultraviolet radiation exposure, and signs of squamous cell carcinoma are the same as basal cell, except it may also show itself as a wart or a scaly growth that bleeds and scabs. And then lastly, you have melanoma, and melanoma is basically melanocytes. It's the most dangerous, and basically you could think of it as melanocytes, they look like an unusual mole. So unlike a normal mole, dark, circular, confined, melanoma mole looks like a spiral ink spot and may display a variety of shades. A melanoma mole can itch, hurt, and feel numb. It can be elevated above the skin surface. The skin around it may turn gray, white, or red. It is the most common in fair-skinned people, particularly if they have suffered many sunburns. It increased the numbers of moles in people. Melanoma rates have doubled in the last decade. It is estimated that 76,000 new cases of melanoma are diagnosed in the United States, and approximately 9,000 fatalities annually. And basically, you recognize it using A, B, C, D. So you look at asymmetry, so it's not perfectly round. It has an oval or an irregular shape. You look at the border irregularity. Does it have notches or indentations? The color, uneven. Several colors may be present: black, brown, tan, red, blue. And then the diameter, larger than 6 millimeters. And then you could also have an E in there called evolving. So the mole has changed size, shape,